native people who may have come up. Glad to see you with us as well. And welcome to those who are listening in from somewhere else beyond Dunedin. Let's join in our usual welcome. Kia noho a ingo, kia koto. God be with you. By hearts, people of God in love.
Bind our lives together in God's grace.
And now we'll light our candle. We light this candle to remind us of the never-failing love of God, the warmth of God's welcome, and our faith in the abiding presence of God. So together we say,
welcome to our place.
Now today we're acknowledging the very first national celebration of the Maori New Year to take place in our country. And so we're going to go adventuring among the star fields that in the very depths of winter herald the hopeful beginning of a new season. And we're going to do that by singing an old hymn. It was written in 1715, so it was a little before the Big Bang theory appeared. And we're going to sing verses 1 to 3 and 6. And I think a lot of us will know this almost instinctively. So let's join in this prayer. God of the galaxies, spinning in space, God of the smallest sea, our living source, yours is the gift of this beautiful place. Let us care for your garden
and your honor the earth.
Careless and covetous, gross are our greeds, taking the riches the garden provides, wasting its goodness, forgetting its needs.
Let us care for your garden and honor the earth.
Forests and rivers are ravaged and die. Raped is the land till it bleeds in its clay, silenced the bird's song, and plundered the sea.
Let us care for your garden and plunder the earth.
Let there be music, and let there be air fragrant with peace, never poisoned with fear, freed from the plagues, pollution and war.
Let us care for your garden and plunder the earth.
Life is a holy thing. Life as a whole, linking each creature and blessing us all, making connections of body and soul.
Let us care for your garden and plant the earth.
Amen. And now we're going to join in Jesus' prayer as it was recorded by the disciples. Let's all join in. Our Father, hallowed be your name.
Your
disciples
come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from the time of trial,
and deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours,
now and forever. And now, something of an adventure. In 1798, that's a long time ago, Joseph Huygens came to England and was much impressed by the first performances he ever heard of the Messiah, which already was being sung by huge choirs and orchestras. Well, being in Austria, he thought, I can do as well, and he asked the British to create a series of texts for him, and he wrote his very, very famous oratorio. It's called The Creation, in which he describes the 7 days as we finally move through the account of the Bible. Well, Haydn had a very large orchestra. He had a very large choir. He did this in England, by the way, first of all. So we're going to be the choir and the orchestra this morning. And I'll lead you into it, as in fact they sing backwards and forwards in the oratorio between the group of soloists and the very large choir. The heavens are telling the glory of the Lord. Telling the glory of the Lord. The firmament displays the wonders of his work. The firmament displays the wonders of his work. The day that is coming hears it from the day, and night shares with night his knowledge about our God. With no speech or language, or sound of any voice, ever, 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 in their maker they rejoice. Their music goes forth to the ends of all the earth.
The music goes forth to the ends of all the earth.
In all the lands is heard the mighty word of God.
In all the lands is heard the mighty word of God.
The vault of the heavens, the canopy of stars, there God has appointed the dwelling of his Son. With no speech or language or sound of any voice, ever, 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 in their maker they rejoice. The sun, like a bridegroom, comes forth to greet the day.
The sun, like a bridegroom, comes forth to greet the day.
Rejoicing in his strength to run his mighty race. His rising is at the bounds of earth and sky.
He circles in fire the edge of time and space. With no speech or language or sound of any voice, ever, 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 ever,
Well, I know you'll all be greatly grieved if I don't tell you the stories. I'm going to tell you the stories. This one comes from Sweden. It's written by Alf Stark. And he voices it in a small boy. I don't think that I can manage a small boy voice, but I'll do my best with the story. It's called When Dad Showed Me the Universe. One day, Dad said he thought I was old enough for him to show me the universe. Where was it? Not very far, he said. Are you going to be warm enough? Asked my mother. It's pretty cold out here. -263 degrees, said Dad, as he put on his black beret, his leather jacket, and his tall brown boots. So I put on an extra pair of socks. Mum hugged us as we left. Don't be late, he said. What actually is the universe? I asked. The entire universe, said my dad, includes everything, my friend. The way there was straight ahead, and then one turn to the left. Is that it? I asked, at the supermarket. No, he said, but we get our provisions there. What are provisions? I asked. Things we buy that you need for an expedition, Dad replied. He knew exactly what we needed. One packet of gum, he told the shop assistant. Do you need anything else, she asked, because we're going to close for the evening. No, that's all, he said. Well, we walked for a very long time. Past the park where the pool was frozen over, past the hardware store, and past the fish shop. They were both closed as well, and it was getting dark. Are we there yet? I asked. Are you tired? Asked Dad. No, I'm not, I said. But I was. He whistled so it would be easier for us to walk. And the tune floated in a white cloud above his black beret. We came to a ditch of water, and Dad carried me across so I wouldn't get wet. We're almost there, he said. By now, there were no street lights at all. Dad led the way through the grass, and we stopped on a small hill. Is this it? I asked. He nodded. I was amazed. This was a place where people went to walk their dogs. Bring out the provisions, he said. Here you are. And so we stood there. And we chewed on our gum. Can you see it? Said Dad. I could see, even though it was pretty dark. I saw a snail from the universe crawling over a stone. And I saw a blade of grass swaying in the winds of the universe. And there was a flower called a thistle. There was Dad staring at the sky. Yes, I whispered, I can see it. All of this was the universe, and I thought it was the most beautiful place I had ever seen. And then Dad looked at me. Don't be silly, he said. You're supposed to look up. I looked up. And 1,000 stars were burning in the sky. Dad pointed them out. He knew their names. See, there's the little bear, he said, and the serpent, and the horse, and the scorpion. And can you see its tail? Well, I couldn't. For me, all the stars swam together like the specks of dust in the living room when the sun shines. Yes, I said, because I didn't want to seem silly again. Up there, everything is clear and still, he said. Everything's in its place. See how calm it makes you feel. I said. That's because it's so big, everything else seems so small. And Dad lifted me up so I'd be closer to the stars that were so far, far away. Some of them don't exist, he said. They've gone out already. But we can still see them, I said. Oh yes, we can see them light, said Dad. It just may take several hundred years for it to arrive here. So I looked hard at the stars that weren't there. And Dad went on telling me their names and carrying me. The swan, he said. The hawk, the big dog. But he was quiet and his nostrils flared. What on earth was that, he said. What, I asked. What's that smell? I knew what he'd stepped in. The dog, I said. And then we went home. Dad had lost his enthusiasm, and he looked at the boot he'd wiped in the grass. You're probably too little to understand anyway, he said. And we walked in silence for a bit. All I wanted was to show you something so beautiful you'd remember it forever, he said, taking my hand. But I know, I said. And when we got home, we had sandwiches and hot chocolate. How was the universe? Asked I. It was beautiful, I said. And very funny. And that's the end. We'll follow up with our scripture readings. They come from very different times in our history. The psalm that you'll hear was written around about 1,000 years BC. The Gospel John passage that we're going to hear was written about 100 AD, both on one side or the other of the book of Jude. Thanks.
And sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honour. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. John 14, New Testament 1-7. Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God and believe in me also. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so, and after I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Now that you have known me, he said to them, you will know my Father also, and from now on you do know him, and you have seen him.
We're going to follow that with another hymn. It's another relatively modern hymn written in 1958 by an American poetess, Elizabeth Haven Burroughs, God of Ages, by whose hand, through years long past, our lives were led. Give us new courage now to stand, new faith to find the paths ahead. With one voice and success. Described for us as a holiday for New Zealanders, with no particular way to celebrate it. A time for gathering with friends and whānau, to reflect on the year that has been, to enjoy the present time, and look forward to the year ahead. Now, there's nothing very new or unusual there. Didn't we do much the same on January 1st ourselves? Gather with friends and whānau, and reflect on the year that has passed, enjoy the moment, and look forward to the year ahead. The Christians, at least, our new year is heralded not by Matariki, but by the appearance of a legendary star, the Star of Bethlehem. We've never seen it, though our astronomers assure us there may have been a flare of light from a passing comet in the heavens around the right time. But modern can point to a real star, actually a star cluster, as the starting point for their seasonal calendar. Matariki is the Māori name for a constellation of seven stars, which can be seen during most of the year, except at the beginning of the cold months, when they disappear from view. And then their reappearance in the pre-dawn sky in the middle of winter is taken as a hopeful sign marking the beginning of a new year. But it can be hard to see Matariki clearly from many parts of this country. So several iwi use a quite different star signal, which appears about the same time as the seventh star cluster. The tribes of Pokanui, Taranaki, parts of the far north, and all those of the South Island recognise this star as Puaka. Modern astronomers know it as Rigel in the constellation of Orion. For thousands of years, we've been watching those stars as they move through our nightly skies. And during uncounted centuries of human evolution, we've used our imagination and our tribal memories to mark their significance. We've drawn imaginary lines from one point of brightness to another, to make pictorial images in the heavens. And we drew them into stories of divine beings, built them into the mythology of many, many cultures. The name Rigel comes from Arabic, and it means the left foot of the giant one. Giant one is Orion. So as early as the 10th century, Arabs, like the ancient Greeks might say, saw up in the heavens a huge figure in the star world with Rigel marking its foot. In northern Australia, the Aboriginal tribes named Rigel the Red Kangaroo Chief, the biggest red kangaroo they could possibly imagine up in the heavens. And I think it's rather nice to think that in Viking mythology, Rigel is called Úlfarnil's toe, again, foot piece of some giant figure in the sky. Now, Japanese culture, which knows nothing of these stories, Rigel represents a great sky family, like one of their own medieval feuding clans. And it's opposed by Betelgeuse, a another large star family that turns up around about the same time. Maury saw Rigel within the framework of a giant kangaroo pigeon, or an enormous pot with a handle. And they named the rising star Puana, and of course related it to Matariki, so Puana is Matariki's older brother. Come back first. And in a practical way, they marked the new year by his rising, because it's the end of the autumn harvest, when the first fruits are eaten during a three-day festival of light. Now the scientists have a different story to tell, all together. It's still a story. For them, Rigel is not one star, but a cluster of four. So close that we see them as a single point of light in the heavens. Heading this cluster, there is a young, hot, massive star, which they do name Rigel. It's young. Well, our sun is about 5 billion years old, and it's only halfway through its life. Rigel, a blue supergiant star, is only 9 billion years old, and it's already used up the supply of oxygen at its core. It's aging, but none of us will see its death. It's doomed to die, to self-destruct in a massive explosion, a supernova, collapsing on itself when it can no longer support its own weight. Don't worry. It's a fair time. It's hot. Boy, is it hot. 21,000 degrees Fahrenheit. It's twice as hot as our sun. And it's massive. Nearly 25 times larger than the sun, with a radius of more than 70 times wider than our sun. And its energy output makes it shine so brightly, it's perhaps 300,000 times brighter than our sun. And how far away? Well, remember that like the solar system, Rigel exists in the Milky Way galaxy, which is only one of the myriad galaxies within our unimaginably vast universe. Rigel is more than 1,000 light years distant from our sun. We are only 8,000 light minutes away from our sun. In the distant future, Maury, if there still are humans in this place, will no longer be able to mark Matariki by Rigel's appearance in the skies above. It just won't be there. And if it now seems to be part of the great Orion constellation, the Greeks call it the Pleiades, that's because of our limited sight lines from here to the star. In fact, the Orion Nebula exists behind Rigel, twice as far from the sun as Rigel is. So yet again, a vast leap out into unimaginable distances in space. Now, I've noticed that the Prime Minister, many others, including Molly, have suggested that this should be a good time for reflection. wonder how many New Zealanders are actually going to do any elections rather than just to do it at home. Well, I've had time, obviously, to do some reflecting. Here am I. First of all, I'm filled with wonder and awe at the scale and the scope of the universe in which we exist as a tiny part. My mind cannot grasp the magnitudes of 21,000 degrees Fahrenheit, or 300,000 times brighter than the sun, or 1,000 light years of travel to reach the source of that little pinpoint of light in the southern skies. I also get a sense of the marvelous human history in which we here and now are playing such a brief part. From caveman animal to modern astronomers, we've all been struck by the wheeling constellations of light moving through our night skies, and we've made what we could. And that leads me to appreciate the astonishing human powers of intelligence, the insatiable curiosity, the capacity for awe and wonder which we alone seem to possess. I have to say seem to possess, because nobody really knows whether there's some being somewhere in the universe is just those powers. In a very simple way, we have become the mind of this universe. But I don't think we can feel too proud about that. Rigel, that giant star, which has had a life much like our own. It was born in some vast explosive conception. In the course of its life, it's experienced a great number of massive changes. The astronomers reckon it's already lost 3 times the mass of our sun. As it slowly grew, and grew is the right word, to red supergiant size, and then contracted down to what it is now. And it's doomed to die in some equally colossal explosion. And if that's so for Rigel, are not our brief lifespans and inevitable deaths any more than tiny echoes of the great lives and gigantic death throes of the entire universe? Most challenging reflection of all for me is this: where on earth is God and all? Is our belief in the Creator beyond or within the known universe well founded? Have we got genuine reasons to believe that the ultimate nature of God is love, and that we may trust to that love throughout our own lives and beyond its earthly conclusion? In the light of what we know or think we know about the universe, what are we going to make of Jesus, who spoke so tenderly and so simply about God as his dad, and held out a very great promise, the promise of a room in the very house of his Father? for one. You are going to deserve from New Zealanders more than 24 hours of time off. And people of faith, of every kind of faith, will do very well to use at least part of the time to fall to deep reflection. Now we're going to sing a group. It's a relatively new hymn. I am a part of the pulse of creation. I wrote this not so long ago, not long after one of our Methodist ministers, Lord Mitchell, asked us to contemplate the age of the universe. Do any of you remember? He laid a rope around the whole room and brought the beginning back to him. He said, where are we in this, this enormous stretch of rope? And of course, with the last knot at the very end, the tiniest fragment at the end of it. You know, you could end up, and I could end up, very, very small and meaningless. That's the thing that might hurt us. What does it matter? Our little flicker of life in this long, long trajectory of time. Well, I think we are important. And we are part of the pulse of creation. Eternity caught in a moment of time. Part of the mystery. Part of the beauty. Part of the wonderful gift of God. So let's see. Service. We join in our prayers concerned for the world in which we live. Let us join in prayer. Lord God, we do understand that you can't stop Russians blasting Ukrainian homes and families' lives to bits. After all, they're both Christians. We get it that you won't intervene to stop some rampaging teenager with an assault rifle, but and kill two in the classroom, or an arranged gunman from spraying bullets at the worshippers inside a mosque. But of course, they're Muslims. We deeply regret that we don't keep the oceans clear of tons of plastic waste. We save the Amazon rainforest from destruction. But we do understand there's only so much we can do. We've never thought that you prevent earthquakes or mudslides from swallowing villages and killing thousands. Your earth just has to go on being the planet of it. The rich have got richer, and the poor have got poorer under your benign eye. How did that happen? You've let the ice melt, and the oceans rise, and drought, firestorms, tornadoes and hurricanes terrify us. It's not a good look. We thought you might have spiked the tires of teenage ramblers and prevented the green small shopkeepers, but you've obviously let that to the loose. So many of the world's millions, we have our own share of them. They're hungry every day. But we notice you haven't sent out any extra rations. What was that rule? You want us to do something about it. So, if this conversation has gone on long enough, amen. I will bring forward. Loving God, take our hands, take our lives, ordinary as grains of wheat, daily as bread. Take our stubborn generosity, our simple actions, and find them good enough to prepare the feast for all your people. Our last hymn is another relatively modern one, written in 1989 by Shirley Murray. Our life as it seasons, and God has the reasons why spring follows winter and new leaves grow. For there's a connection with our resurrection that flowers will bud after frost and snow.
Thank you.
Hughson. We now extinguish this candle. Let us say together. In the living this day and the week to come, may we find the courage to let go of our fears, to accept the challenges before us. May we be open to the still small we know to be grounded in holiness. May our souls be filled with awe at the possibilities we who seek light, yet stand in its constant glory, say Amen. And now, in the
Yeah, so we're pretty